Miss Petrie, how you doing?
Yeah, fine. I'm just not sure whether this car wanted out or not, but it's all good. He's out now.
Well, see how I come from the West Coast, so I have a thick Scottish accent.
Okay.
Well, imagine if I took the feel of my tongue and then I started talking like this. Does that remind you of anything?
Do you know what? That reminds me of a simile, actually.
A simile?
Yeah.
Maybe a poem?
Yes, it does remind me of a poem. Originally by Caroline Duffy.
Excellent. Okay, so originally, we came from our own country in a red room which fell through the fields. What's the red room?
Is it not a train carriage or something?
Like yeah.
Trains and that have red seats and things.
So if we think about this as the view of the child, mm-hmm. So she's young at this stage, so it's how kids see the world.
Yeah.
So what would a kid think was a magical red room which falling through fields? Yeah, I reckon a train. Some think car, but...
Yeah, I think though as well, like the red could be symbolic of something as well, because I've seen trains with like blue seats and stuff like that. Like, they're not always red.
So like she's been torn out of her country, so...
Yeah, like blood and pain.
Okay.
Been ripped.
That's interesting. I kind of get like the primary colours of how a child sees the world.
Okay, yeah.
Like sort of Peppa Pig illustrations and all that.
Yeah, there's also that, but then they could have chosen any colour, but red is particularly evocative, I think. Sort of anger.
Red for danger.
Yeah.
Stranger
danger.
Even kids know that, yeah, like traffic lights.
Yeah,
okay. And falling through the fields, so trains don't really fall through fields, do they?
I don't think so. I've certainly never been in a train that falls. But I think it's this idea, like, she's using the train, she's kind of personifying the train so that it kind of recreates her emotions. It's like she feels like she's out of control, like she's falling.
Yeah, so loss of control is really important
here. Yeah.
And again, child's view. So, our mother singing our father's name to the turn of the wheels. Thoughts on that?
So, this is a bit that I always find funny, like, I don't know, does it imply that the father already lives in this new place and that they're going there to be with him?
What I like about this is that there's no clear answer. One idea is that the father's not there anymore.
Yeah.
And so it's to soothe them because they're upset about it. There's a source of anxiety which would tie in with him already being somewhere
else.
Yeah. It could be that they left the father behind.
But then, later on in the poem, it mentions my parents' anxiety stirred like a loose tooth.
So we mustn't read too much into this. I just thought it could even be that, like, for whatever reason, like families of wee in-jokes, maybe mm-hmm. the noise of the train sounds like the father's name, and it's just
yeah,
a game
like
that
if it
played.
Was like Kevin, Kevin.
Yeah. Daddy. My brothers cried, one of them bawling, home, as the miles rushed back to the city. So, what have we got there? The brothers crying.
It's a bit of contrast there, because she's kind of sitting, she's a bit older, so she's kind of sitting, quietly contemplating, you know, the loss of her home. Whereas the brothers are young, so their emotions are more on the surface. So that's why they're crying, kind of causing a bit more of a scene compared to Duffy herself.
Yeah, and very, very clear, home, obviously, sort of showing that they're aware that they're being pulled away from their home and it's disturbing to them.
Yeah.
And then as the miles rushed back to the city, I'll finish. As the miles rushed back to the city, the street, the house, the vacant rooms where we didn't live anymore. So it's sort of back to front.
Yeah, it kind of uses like a... Well, two things at play. It uses a sort of a cinematic technique whereby it zooms in kind of closer and closer to the place that she wants to be. So, what is it? First city, then home, then the room.
I like that, yeah. So, it's sort of like a cutaway.
Yeah, but also it's the fact the reason why the miles rush back is not because the train is going backwards, but because Duffy's kind of thoughts are pulling her backwards, so it's her mind that's going back, but the train's obviously going forwards.
Ah, interesting. Yeah, so it works in two ways. I really like the cinematic idea. So really, it's a way to sort of relate the imagery there. Where we didn't live anymore. So yeah, a sort of like quite a clear statement there. I think until that point in the stanza, you don't really know for sure that they've what's going on.
Like, so they could just be going on a holiday.
Yeah, your standard technique in a lot of poems of sort of drip feeding information and almost like a puzzle, you're sort of working out what's going on as it goes along. I stared at the eyes of a blind toy holding its paw.
Yeah, so I think the blind toy kind of symbolises how she feels, like she's been disempowered, like
she has no control
over
where she's going.
She lacks control about where it is that she's actually going. She doesn't know what to expect. And also the fact that it's a toy kind of shows that she's still in childhood, but then also the fact that it's a blind toy maybe kind of indicates that it's an older toy, which implies that she's at the stage where she's kind of coming out of childhood, like she won't be using that toy much longer, which again highlights the contrast between her and her brothers.
So there's a lot more going on than just her holding on to a comforting toy.
Yeah.
Okay, excellent. Moving on to the... Oh, in fact, we do the stanza as a whole. I suppose we can sum that stanza up as leaving or emigrating.
Yeah.
The process of leaving Scotland and coming to London. So Duffy's moving from... So in real life, she moved from Glasgow to London.
Yeah.
And I think all through this stanza, the words chosen are quite childlike. They're the kind of words kids would use, and I think a lot of the imagery is quite childish.
Yeah, definitely.
So as we move through the poem, that's not always going to be the case.
No, because we sort of see a kind of turning point, which I don't want to spoil it right now, but yeah, there's a turning point coming up.
Hold on for that one. We've got a treat coming. All childhood is an emigration.
Yeah.
Okay, so this is one of these great lines you get. There's a few more photographer. But it's the line that sums up the whole poem. It tells you exactly what the poem is about. Childhood is a journey. So the literal journey of moving, then metaphors, yeah, those again. The metaphorical journey from childhood to adulthood.
Yeah.
You don't just go from being a baby to 18 one day. It's obviously a series of events. You've probably worked that out for yourselves by now. So, some are slow, leaving you standing resigned up an avenue where no one you know stays.
Yeah, so like for example, when I was young, until I went to uni, I never moved house. But at the same time, obviously between my first memory of when I was like 2 years old and, you know, just before leaving house when I was like, 16, 17 years old, lots of changes do happen. And so that's why childhood is an immigration, even if it is quite a slow one, is because over time you yourself transform as a result of the experiences you have. So similarly to how, when you write your personal reflective essay, you're writing about how an event has changed you. Duffy here is acknowledging that there is an accumulation of events, both big and small, that ultimately lead to shaping you as the person that you become.
I think as well, this is a very physical thing, that, moving country. It's a large event that you're very aware of, it's built up to, and it's something that comes for months,
and then
you anticipate a big effect, a big impact. Whereas, if I continue, others are sudden, your accent wrong. So if we think of Duffy as a child in, when would this be, like 50s, 60s?
Really bad at guessing ages.
Well, certainly, it would be a while ago.
Yeah.
And children don't have a concept of country when they're born. It's something that they learn.
Yeah.
But at no point is she going to have thought, before moving, I sound like Ouija. But then suddenly she opens her mouth in the middle of London and people are telling her that she sounds wrong. There's something which she didn't know was there, which marks her as different. So it's unexpected, and this sort of thing she couldn't help the marks are, that's suddenly, that's your sudden change.
Yeah.
Then we've got corners which seem familiar, leading to unimagined pebble-dashed estates.
Yeah, so that's the kind of idea that, you know, I mean, she's only moved within the UK, so the streets are basically the same, and she kind of feels a sense of recognition, but then once she you know, walks around a corner that looks like, you know, a corner that she would have known from Glasgow, from her home, she's then like, oh, I don't know where I am anymore, and that's because she's unfamiliar with this new environment, these new surroundings.
I find it quite unpleasant, quite harrowing, this idea of, she sort of feels like these moments of recognition, and then they're pulled away from under her.
Yeah.
She doesn't stop looking. It's quite upsetting. Then big boys eating worms and shouting words you don't understand.
Yeah. So it's kind of the idea that in this new place, you know, the people are threatening, like eating a live creature is quite. Quite a barbaric act in a way, so to her, like, that's very threatening. The fact that they're big boys as well, I mean, adds to the intimidation factor. And I presume that sort of the words you don't understand are kind of curses or local dialect, so that's a further level of intimidation.
Yeah, so if it's curses, it's maybe more adult, but yeah, then dialectual, I suppose, that just relates to the theme of changing languages. The phrase big boys is interesting, a bit of alliteration there for you. Because that suggests to me that she's noticeably younger than the other kids. But then, then if they're going around eating worms, is this some kind of rite, some ritual? But then on the other hand, maybe they just seem big because they're threatening.
Yeah.
There's a lot of questions here and no clear answers. My parents' anxiety stirred like a loose tooth in my head.
So I like that one, actually, because it's like, well, you know when you're a kid and you have a loose tooth and you're like, do you know what, it's quite close to coming out? So you just like sit and wiggle it and then it gets to the point where it's just a little string and you keep twisting it, but it's still there and you're constantly aware of it and constantly like poking it with your tongue, poking it with your fingers. So it's always on your mind, whether consciously or subconsciously.
See, your description, it just makes me sort of feel that in a really visceral way. And I think that's what's really good about it. I feel that... that simile in my spine.
Yeah.
It gets right, it makes me shiver a little bit. Mm-hmm. It, you know, I can really feel what she's getting at there. And again, it's two things here. One, losing teeth is something that happens to children. So it's the childhood experience, the emigration from childhood to adulthood.
Which is something I forgot to tell my class. So if you're watching this, my class, remember that. And add
tell your friends.
Yeah, tell everyone.
And further, the idea of mouth things. We've had the big boys eating worms, and now we've got a loose tooth.
Yeah.
But there's a combination here of ideas about sound and about words, mm-hmm. and about physical things like insects and teeth in the mouth. Again, like, we could come up with different reasons for this, and maybe we'll talk about this at the end, but. There's a link there. I'm not too.
Whoop. Again, spoiler alert.
Yeah. So, I want our own country, I said. She said it in italics, so you know she was serious.
Oh yeah, and emotional.
I think there. Yeah, if you think of the way.
Like longing. I want my own country.
It's deep, very powerful. I think she's. In the way that when a kid says something and they mean it with every fibre of their being, and when you become an adult, you know, there's maybe always a sense that I might not be able to follow through on this, I might not be able to get my own way. You know, things become a lot more shades of grey.
Yeah.
Whereas as a child, this is black and white to her.
Yeah.
So. Final. Well, we think the second stanza, it's the adjustment, it's the arriving in London, and...
Yeah, the initial kind of fear, and the fear of the unknown.
Yeah. So, yeah, imagine going into enemy territory, and the things that happen there. So, final stanza, but then you forget, or don't recall, or change. And seeing your brother swallow a slug, feel only a scalp of shame. So we start with a wee list there. You forget or don't recall or change. A list there showing sort of time passing.
Yeah, and it also shows as well that you remember something in your life being difficult, even if you don't really, like, you remember feeling sad, but it's not like every time you think of it, you conjure up the same intensity of emotion.
Yeah, yeah. So yeah, your emotions change as you grow. Again, the journey, the emigration, the childhood journal. Now, seeing your brother swallow a slug. So this ties to the big boys eating the worms.
Yeah. So this time it's her own brothers that are doing it. So rather than the scary big boys, it's her younger brothers. So they're doing something that's equally barbaric, but this time she's just like, meh, there's the kids swallowing a slug.
So it's not. You think it's a right that they have to do this in this part of London?
To be honest, I think it's just a thing that boys seem to do.
So it's more just sort of slugs and snails and puppy dog tales than anything else. So we shouldn't read into this too much.
I mean, I wouldn't read into it too far, apart from the fact that it, you know, slugs and worms are particularly kind of disgusting, which adds to the idea that she could be repulsed by this. Whereas if it was just like, oh, they were eating a chicken nugget, like, it'd just be like, oh, there's a group of big boys eating a chicken nugget.
What's the strange place? All the big boys were eating
barbecue
KFC.
Sauce of all things.
To be honest, on any given day, I might rather eat a slug than KFC. Certainly, I think slugs are better for you, but I'm getting off the topic here. Feel only a scalp of shame. So, the word scalp.
Aye, Scottish.
It's not just Scottish, it's West Coast. These East Coast kids don't seem to understand it. Or know what it means.
Well, I knew what I meant, and I'm East Coast.
Aberdeen's just its own thing. It's where nobody goes or wants to go. So, scalp, what does it mean?
It means, I was going to say a wee bit. So, a little bit.
A little bit?
Yes.
Little.
A small amount. A minute quantity.
A tiny amount. Just a tiny amount. I think of it as a splinter. So if you get a splinter,
that's
a scalp.
Okay.
But she only feels... But the splinter, it's really small. Just a tiny bit of wood stuck in your finger. The point being that it's a Scottish word.
Splinter point.
It's a Scottish word. So basically... she only feels a little bit of shame for betraying Scotland and becoming increasingly at home in London.
But she still uses the Scottish word, which implies that despite having become somewhat detached from her roots through growing up, she still is kind of inextricably linked to her past.
Yeah, yeah, it's all part of the journey.
Yeah.
From childhood to adulthood.
The emigration.
Ah. So, I remember my tongue shedding its skin like a snake.
Mouth again.
Yeah, yeah. So, I mean, we've gone from worms to slugs, and now there's a snake in her mouth. Except it's not. It's a metaphor. It's a simile. It's a simile.
Imagine if your tongue actually did shed its skin. That would be rank.
Ugh. But imagine how clean your tongue would be afterwards.
It'd be amazing.
Kids, shed your tongues. What does this mean? Well, let's keep reading. My voice in the classroom sounding just like the rest.
Okay, I get it now. So it's this thing like, you know, regeneration. Her voice is changing as she becomes, you know, used to the new way of speaking. Her accent's transforming, moving away from her Glaswegian accent into... accent, which is why it's like shedding its skin, because it's changing the way she speaks.
And why is it a snake shedding its skin? Because she's been joining Scotland.
Yeah, so I think it's this idea of snakes, you associate them with like taboo, with evil, so it's this kind of idea that maybe she feels that sense of betrayal.
Yeah, so again, yeah, we had this in the last one with Havisham. Mm-hmm. The snake is something word choice, betrayal, the betrayer, think of your Garden of Eden, and by shedding her accent, like a snake sheds its skin, she has betrayed Scotland and taken on the values of London. And she's done that for survival. Now she sounds just like everyone else in the classroom, and people don't bother about her voice. Do I only think I lost a river, culture, speech, sense of first base in the right place? So another sort of abstracty list. What have we got here? A river?
Clyde.
A culture?
Glasgow. Scottish.
Speech?
Dialect.
Sense of first base in the right place?
Like her home in Glasgow?
Yeah, yeah. So the place where that was all she'd ever known.
Yeah, like she belongs.
And she's always got that little longing for it.
Yeah.
Now, where'd you come from, strangers ask? Originally? And I hesitate.
So, I read that slightly differently. I always go like, oh, where do you come from? Originally. Because it's like when people ask me that, I always get confused. Or not that I'm confused about where I come from. But although I guess so as well, because if people from Edinburgh ask, oh, where do you come from? I would say up north in Aberdeen. Whereas if people from like, I don't know, down in England ask me where I came from, I would say Edinburgh because that's where I live now. So it's sort of like, it's an ambiguous question because it is like, where do I come from? Do you mean where have I travelled from today, or where do I come from originally in the first place?
But if Duffy then starts saying from Scotland, people are going to say you don't sound very Scottish.
Yeah.
What are you doing in the SQA syllabus? And she's going to have to explain. She's going to have to recite this book to explain. That's probably why she wrote it.
She probably just carries around copies just to slide to people. She's like, my credentials.
Here you go. Why is this a fitting end to the poem? How does it sum up everything?
So it brings you back to the idea that actually she doesn't know how to answer the where do you come from question. Because while she knows that she is from Scotland and specifically Glasgow, now she doesn't feel as much of a tie to that place because she's lived in England for so long at this point. Hesitates because she's like, am I from Scotland? Am I from England?
Yeah, yeah, so it resolves this issue.
Yeah.
And it shows that, although she's moved on, she's always got this sort of connection.
Yeah.
And this sort of threads through the whole poem. So what themes have we got here?
Change.
Change, loss.
Yeah.
Identity.
Yeah, time.
First person narrator.
Yeah, I mean, I wouldn't say that's a theme, but in terms of the final textual analysis question, certainly a
problem. Yeah, I'm just jumping ahead here.
I know, your brain just works faster than mine.
That's not something I hear very often.
You also get contrast as well. One of the questions in a past paper asked about how Duffy uses contrast. So there's contrast between how she felt when she first moved versus how she feels now.
Yeah, I was getting some questions from my class about that, and that was quite a tricky one. Yeah. The contrast in this poem. And you've got contrast between old and young as well.
Yes.
So old and young, Scottish English. Slugs and worms. don't write about that.